we're at a fair, we're at a fairly basic entry level with most of our clients, and that's the way we work with them. We like to work with them on a retainer basis, so that they actually develop their HR knowledge. And we don't like getting those phone calls where something has already happened and they're ringing you to try to resolve an issue and they've already, you know, made aims of it. So today's, just for the next 10 minutes or so, I'm just going to briefly touch on one slide, just the importance of HR policies in an organization. Just spend a few minutes talking about hybrid working. And thirdly, the importance of wellness in the workplace. And again, I'll maybe give my examples from my experience working in HR in different countries. So just a little bit, as I said, about GHR Consulting. We have an office on Dominic Street, and we work at the moment with probably about 35 or 40 clients. So they basically outsource their HR function to us. So this is everything from contracts to recruitment support to HR policies to compliance. Some of them might have WRC inspections and they call you. Some of them might have, you know, high turnover of staff and they're looking for things like, okay, well, what can we do to improve retention? Is it just paying them more, or is it actually, well, maybe let them work from home 2 days a week, or maybe actually, you know, give them bonuses every now and again, or maybe set up a wellness program, or get them involved in the bike to work scheme, or, you know, set them up in a pension. You know, some of them you might say, well, maybe doing an employee survey to actually find out what it is they want and what are the issues. Sometimes it can just be one or two particular issues that can resolve a lot of the issues within the workplace. So we kind of, a lot of the time when we start with clients, it's more basic queries. And then over time, we kind of get called about literally everything. And Alison, I was asked for tax advice from a guy I was dealing with this week. So it's good fun. And in fairness, we've a team of four now, whereas this time last year, it was just myself. And we're actually looking for a fifth employee at the moment. So if anybody knows a good young HR consultant that wants to get involved, then send them my way. Okay, so the importance of HR policies in an organization. So again, these are really tools that protect the employers. There's 30 pieces of employment legislation for the employee, and there are zero for the employers. So what we're saying to employers is really, you need to make sure that you've up-to-date HR policies and that you understand them, and you know that they basically accurately reflect the company's position with regards to everything from sick pay to if there's disciplinary to working from home. So a big one at the moment is creating working from home policies. So you're kind of saying to the clients, you need to lay out the ground, you know, what are the rules around working from home? I think what you saw at the start was it was a bit of a free for all where some people say, well, I'm not going back to the office and there's nothing you can do about it. So companies were keen to bring in a working from home policy to, you know, to just make so everybody felt they're being treated fairly. The other ones are things around wellness. You know, you could even have a wellness policy. What is it that the company is going to do to, you know, to look after their employees' long-term health and well-being? I worked in Dubarry for 4 years at Ballinasloe as HR manager. And one thing I remember we did there, we brought in an occupational nurse for 3 days. So everybody got a free health checkup. And I remember I always said, it's the only thing I ever did out there that nobody complained about. Everything else, be it a Christmas party or a summer barbecue or a day at the races, there'd always be someone giving out. There was too much drink, there was too little drink, there was too many people in the bus, there was too few people. But the time we brought in that nurse, I think it was every second year, that was the one particular benefit we brought in where nobody actually complained, which was, you know, a good sign in itself. So that was just a very small one. But just going back to the HR policies, they can create mutual benefits for employees and employers. They do increase employee motivation. I see this every day where an employee maybe is misbehaving, they're not being dealt with, and employees just leave. I just off the phone to one of my retail managers today, and they had three staff leave over the manager because it hasn't been dealt with, and only now they're kind of dealing with it. Organizational reputation, especially in a small city like Galway, I could name the two or three businesses that I would not recommend anyone work there for love nor money. Including somewhere I work myself, but we won't go into that. Talent attraction and retention. Again, how do you hold on to your good staff? You know, once you get them in the door, you think that's the hard part done, but you know, it's how do you keep them motivated to want to stay working with you? The policies kind of help you avoid involvement with employment tribunal claims, and they support the attitudes and behaviors needed for sustainable performance. Okay, so I'm just to have three or four slides just around hybrid working. I mean, I always give the example of myself when I worked in Dubarry, and they're actually a client now as a, as a consultant. I mean, I worked there for 4 years, commuting in and out to, from Galway, you know, an hour each way, 100 euros a week, petrol and tolls. I never did an hour from home. And now if I was working for them, I'd say, well, I'm only going to go into Banisloe 3 days a week. And if you don't like it, you know, I'll look elsewhere. So that's, you know, that's that would have been unheard of even for them 2.5 years ago. So in effect, the hybrid working is a flexible work model. It supports obviously the blend of in-office and working from home. And it basically gives the employees the autonomy to choose where they feel they're most productive. So obviously some employees may want to continue to work from home full time. Most would prefer a balance where they do some days in the office, some days at home. We kind of saw a large number of people who were refusing to return to the workplace. And it kind of came down to, look, your contract of employment says your place of work is the office. So if it comes to, if you want to quit, you can, but I'm in the right here because the contract states where your place of work is. But in fairness, most employers try to reach some kind of balance where it's maybe 50% at home, 50% in the workplace. And most organizations are kind of doing a hybrid work situation at the moment. But you're seeing it with we do an awful lot of recruitment, and clients who are coming looking for jobs, the first question they ask is, how many days do I need to be in the office? And usually it's, okay, for the first month or two, you need to be in the office maybe full time. And after that, once you've done your training or have kind of built up, I suppose, the trust to a certain degree that you can maybe work more from home. So organizations do need to give careful consideration to the contractual implications of hybrid working. So need to make clear that if an employee makes a formal request to work from home, you know, it can result in basing the change to the terms and conditions of employment. So there are 10 core terms and conditions of employment. One of them is the place of work. So what a lot of employers do is they may agree to a request just for maybe a period of time, maybe 6 months or 12 months, and review it then. And that's usually what I'd advise them, rather than commit to something and then find they're stuck with it because maybe everybody wants to do it. So it's sometimes easier to commit for maybe 6 or 12 months and review it then to see if it's working for both parties. And again, hybrid working, sometimes it can be on an informal basis. I have that with my own staff. I just kind of say, you know, ideally come into the office, but you know, if it's raining, don't be killing yourself trying to get into the office, you know. And you know, both of them are partners in Dublin, so I know they like Fridays to be maybe work from home. So again, it's just about being flexible. So some people just do it informally. And again, employment contracts should need to state the location. So it's important that you're clear in the contract that where the place of work is and where they're expected to be on a daily basis. So just regards a hybrid working policy, it should contain which type of roles are eligible for hybrid working, explain how to request a hybrid working. So usually it would be you put the request in writing and kind of give some maybe justification for it. Verifying the roles and responsibility for hybrid workers, that'll be things like, you know, health and safety, you know, timekeeping, etc. How it intersects with other forms of flexible working. And reviewing other policies, you know, such as IT usage, data protection, expense policy and stuff like that, how they'd be affected by someone working from home. And just a quick side really on the current legislation, so that there's remote working, so the government's in the process of the right to request remote working bill. And basically it provided a legal framework which employees could request to work from home. There was a small bit of, you know, anger from trade unions because there was 13 reasons that employers could give to basically refuse a request. So I think Leo Varadkar said last week that they're under review, so they're going to try and tighten them up a little bit. So it's not just a blanket, you know, employers can basically say, oh, because of business reasons, you can't work from home. So they're trying to make it a little bit more specific as for refusing people. And all employers must provide a written statement which establishes the remote working policy, and basically specifying the manner in which remote working requests are managed. And again, the benefits, which I know will be touched on later in the presentation, your better work-life balance, greater ability to focus with fewer distractions, more time for family and friends, saving commuting time and costs, and IT upskilling and higher levels of motivation. Definitely the commuting costs for me is the biggest thing I find. And just couple of points in the drawbacks: unbalanced environment, loss of in-person communication, employees more susceptible to burnout, and again, it's not suitable for all organizations. Okay, so that's the last bit about hybrid. And just I just have a couple of slides on the importance of wellness in the workplace. Again, I've worked, you know, in Australia, New Zealand, London, Dublin, and Galway now in HR. And you see different things like wellness in the workplace can mean anything. One of the big things I brought in to Barry, it was just basic. It was baby steps. We started off with a bowl of fruit every Monday. And it's like, okay, what's the catch? Like, there's no catch. We just buy fruit for the staff on a Monday morning. And it lasts a week. And that's a really easy one. I'd often say to people, if you don't need to go in with this gigantic, you know, wellness program and, you know, bells and whistles, just start off with something nice and easy. And then it might develop into, you know, some of the points I'm going to touch on in a second. Like a wellness program could be organized activity in the workplace, you know, be it physical or mental exercises. And basically they're about promoting and building the healthier habits between employees and their teams to keep them motivated. And again, if someone comes home, if there's maybe an exercise program, if someone comes home to their partner and they're telling them about it, you know, I'm sure their partner's thinking, oh, that's great. They're looking out for your physical well-being. You know, there can be stress management education. There could be mental health awareness or, you know, various, you could get in guest speakers, you know, on the last Friday of every month, you know, some meditation sessions, healthy eating workshops. Again, you might get in a nutritionist to give a talk for half an hour during lunch break. You know, give some packed lunch or snack ideas. Some people kind of have a charity day or a volunteer day. And again, sense of accomplishment. Or some of the wellness challenges, I saw that worked very well in London and Canary Wharf. I worked on Crossrail there and, you know, they had probably 200 people almost competing against each other with their 10,000 steps. So look, there are lots of different things you can do that aren't necessarily going to, you know, cost a lot of money for the business. And just really finishing up just a couple of slides, I suppose the benefits of wellness programs, they do increase productivity. They definitely increase employee engagement in the workplace and morale. They reduce stress levels. They improve employee health. They reduce absenteeism. They definitely help with talent and retention and attraction. Promotes a good work-life balance. A good sense of accomplishment, and it elevates the company culture. And the big thing now is the employer branding, you know, where people are competing for talent. So if you have a strong wellness program you can boast about to new employees, it's only going to be beneficial to the company. And just the last slide really, I suppose, how to effectively implement wellness programs. So really the only aid employees if the programs are accessible and appealing. It's all about really encouraging as many employees to participate. And employers should make sure the programs align with employee schedules and not interfere with their non-working hours. So there's no point putting on all these events, you know, at 6 p.m. when people want to be at home. You know, ideally lunchtime or maybe first thing in the morning. You know, it's no harm to say, well, we're going to start just half an hour early. But, you know, again, being reasonable, but you don't want to put everything outside of working hours. And employees should view the wellness activity as beneficial, worthwhile, rather than something they're being forced to do and kind of frowned upon if they don't attend. Again, in my experience, there are some great ones. It's not all about spending huge amounts of money. There are some really basic, easy steps. Even the bike to work scheme is a good one. Get people cycling to work. It costs the company nothing really, and the employees are usually very happy with it. So, yeah, that's really about it. If anyone has any questions, I don't know if we'll chat about them at the end or now. So I will hand it back to Nicola.
Thanks, Rory. Yeah, if anyone has any questions for Rory now, you can ask or you can wait to the end, whatever works for yourselves. And yeah, you'd write really good points there, Rory, especially I think a lot of people for employers is to make sure that there is the points that I suppose everything's in clear detail. For even the wellness programs, for signing up for the hybrid at home, I think everything just needs to be clear so everyone's on the exact same page. And again, even with the wellness side of things, it is important for companies to definitely be promoting more wellness. And so you made really good points there. Even start small and you can grow bigger. But it is all about just trying to keep your employees, I suppose, just happier and de-stressed, and they have a better chance of staying in the workplace then.
Yeah.
Perfect. Okay. So I have Richella, you are up next.
Excellent. Shall I just jump in?
Yeah, go for it. Thanks, Julian.
Brilliant. And I'm curious, just even starting off before I even introduce myself, at the moment in how you're arriving today, are you more biased to the benefits of hybrid or remote working, or are you more biased to the challenges? B or a C in the chat box, please. Are you more biased to the benefits, or are you more biased to the challenges? That's one B, keep going. So that's really even good to know starting off. Because actually, really, what we need to be considering is that it's actually neutral. It's actually neutral. There is equal challenges to benefits from hybrid working and remote working. So we need to think that through. So I want us to even start thinking about ourselves, firstly, as nervous systems. Would you agree you're a nervous system? You've got a head brain, you've got a heart brain, and you've got a good brain. So you're not all about performance and getting stuff done. You're actually a whole human. You're a whole human. So between now and Christmas, every single day, I am teaching how to manage wellness in a blended workforce. Imagine, I am absolutely block booked teaching managers how to manage in a blended workforce, just to be able to catch hold of, actually, what is the difference between a human nervous system working in a previously traditional face-to-face environment to what actually is necessary in a blended working environment. So let's think it through. So let's walk through the differences and let's see how we fall out of the other side, just in terms of respect. In the old days, hark back to 2 years ago, would you agree everybody knew who they were going to be showing up around? There was a fixed certainty to, I know what to expect when I go. I know who I'm going to see when I go. I know that I'll be having the informal social chats. I know that social inclusion will happen just by me being there. I know that my buddy will probably go, Asher, it's okay. It's not today. Asher, you're just in a bad mood. I could expect to get to know people, not even having had a conversation with them. If it was myself, and I'm going to use you as an example, Patrick, I would know, even by not having spoken to Patrick on a day, what is his energy like? Does he light up the room when he comes in? Is he a bit grumpy when he gets into a bad mood? And they're all the things that kind of informally inform that trust and rapport. All those implicit ways of working is what gave our nervous systems something to cling on to. But they were expected, and there was a certainty and a predictability with that in mind. Does that make sense? So again, even how we co-located, learned on the go, shared our private life, et cetera, that sort of certainty and predictability is what we're actually now in a post-COVID blended model exploration, where actually nobody has all the answers. At this moment, nobody really knows how best to manage, particularly because there's people who still have to be front facing, whose roles don't permit them to be, you know, home all the time or home in a blended way. There's people who then have to be between the office and different management roles and responsibilities. And there's people who have jobs who actually could easily work from home. So it's about us saying to ourselves, actually, there is, what is it to get stuff done, head? But what is it about how we need to treat each other differently that we need to reimagine in a blended workforce so that we can start getting a bit more predictability and certainty back into human systems, so that anticipation and forecasting into the future, even though the environment is threatening enough, that we take the threat out of how do we show up in a blended working environment. So a lot of this has to be much more intentional in terms of how we communicate, much more intentional about how we stay connected, much more intentional and proactive in terms of how we reimagine how work gets done. How do we use the office now as a tool instead of a destination, completely different to the way it used to be? How can we actually rotate together and have and support each other with structured transfer of knowledge, so we're not getting ahead of ourselves? We're actually being able to help with that all the time. What is it we need to take care of in terms of inclusion by design? Does that make sense? Inclusion actually by design. So we have to get much more explicit in how we document, how we record keep, how we communicate, and we have to get miles ahead. And nobody's going to be good at even implementing these things tomorrow. It's saying to ourselves, aspirationally, we need to start with the end in mind to go, what actually do we want to be as a workforce? So depending on the companies, what do we want to walk away with from 12 months? And then what's the impact individually going to be for different people as they show up? It looks different for somebody who's at the end of their career, who has more, you know, wisdom in their system, but they might be more likely to put the oxygen mask on everybody else before themselves. That's a different type of burnout. There might be younger people who are showing up in a work environment who just want to belong and have more status challenges and value fairness differently. Does that make sense? There's different people arriving to work for different reasons. So how do we respect all of those things? So again, for us, we want to be very conscious and careful that when we consider the benefits, and my God, there's a list as long as your arm of benefits, and I bet you we could go to town on them, from financial to all the other things. But if we're not mindful for the challenges, we've completely missed the target. But they're going to be much more in how we treat each other. The human aspect of people needs to be in balance with how do we actually get work done. Does that make sense? So it's really important for us to be able to think, even when it comes down to things like isolation and loneliness, for example. Isolation and loneliness doesn't happen overnight. So the short-term win, the short-term benefit of staying at home for some, brilliant. But for some people, they're brilliant for 6 months. Suddenly something in their system changes. We're systems connected to other systems. We're in systems. If something in our system changes, then suddenly isolation and loneliness can become a thing where our system is very reduced and suddenly we get out of whack, we get isolated and we get lonely. For some people, it might take a year. For some people, it takes 3 years. It is real and it is a real thing. How do we then know what goes on within our teams? So psychological safety is not a new concept. That's been around for years, but it's been the diverse who've really had to learn it. Now it needs to be a thing that everybody understands. How do we create psychological safety where we actually can see what goes on in terms of how people treat each other when we're in a remote environment? Because some of the things we can also lose sight of. Am I going too fast? Or are you keeping up? Are we okay? Yeah. So again, we're just raising the challenges, because even I was working with somebody recently who 30 years ago got isolated and got stuck for 30 years. I was working with another manager who's managing a massive workforce, and he suddenly found that something called proximity bias is having him pay more to the people he can see, whereas the people who are at home are out of sight, out of mind. How do we stay connected? How intentional do you now need to be? What has recency bias got to do with everything? What are the hierarchies that form where we have in-groups and out-groups? I'm dealing with people at the moment who are in WhatsApp groups, in-group, out-groups being I'm not included in the WhatsApp group. These are micro-stresses that can build up where there's a massive impact on all of us. So leadership is changing, management styles have to change. Traditional leadership got thrown out with the bathwater years ago. It's coming back with a vengeance, because we have to get really good at balancing now agile leadership and traditional leadership. And one of the particular things we have to pay attention to particularly is trust. How do you inform trust in a blended working environment? How many assumptions can we make that we are trusted if you're in a management position? How do you inform that trust? And what informs trust besides credibility, reliability, authenticity, accountability, good communication, is something called intimacy. Into me see, boundary to professional intimacy, where I just get to see people. I get to experience them, and they're not showing up on a postage stamp where I'm getting the false signals because they're not great online. Some people have horrible resting faces on a camera, but they're actually nice and soft and goodly if you actually got to know them. That's the truth. So how do we build rapport? How do we ask questions? How do we listen to each other? Everybody needs new skills. So it works really well if you want to come and learn coaching. Coaching skills really help with this. How do we learn how to regulate ourselves and our own nervous system in a blended environment? How do we regulate and help others regulate their own nervous system in a blended working environment. There's so much context to go into this. It's not something that you just drive by really quickly. And I was working with the team today, and what they were saying was, I have no idea how to manage myself at home. I haven't a clue how to manage my own boundaries. So one of the things I was alerting them to was, if you are managing a team, and this particular lady had 60 people on her team, on her normal team, and she was saying, and I said, so what does that look like in terms of how it shows up, you know, you not being able to manage your boundaries? And she said, well, you know, I'm online all day and everything else. And I said, so what do you think the implied meaning is that you're giving people in terms of your behavior? And she said, well, I tell everybody that they need to take their lunch breaks. I tell everybody that they need to disconnect. And I said, so are you trying to tell me that if you tell me to not take a lunch break, yet I know you're sitting at the desk not taking a lunch break, that you think that I'm going to not take a lunch break? There's an implied meaning to our behavior. And I said, so what time do you send your emails at? And she said, oh, yeah, I do. I sent one at 11 o'clock last night. And I said, you've an absolute cheek. Imagine. The implied meaning means what? So your behavior is setting the culture and context. And she was shocked at herself. And she's like, I really wish people could switch off. And I said, you have to start with you. And I said, you have personal responsibility to manage your own behavior first. You absolutely do teach people how to treat you. But at the same time, there are different generations showing up with different levels of threat and uncertainty about whether they even feel like they're going to be keeping their job. Part of good communication too is to be saying to somebody, if it was Dorothy, for example, and she was just young and starting off, I know her nervous system is thinking, am I going to have a job tomorrow? So what can I do? I could be saying to Dorothy, as we're working towards adapting to a remote blended working environment, let's think about how this is going to work about 3 months, in 3 months, 6 months, 9 months. And not that it's about the day to day. I know Dorothy's nervous system's going, oh, thank God, she thinks I'm going to be here in 6 months. Does that make sense? There's so much to this. We can't just drive past and go. We actually need to really re-educate around this. The collegiality part is massive. How do we actually belong? I had an entire organization feel I actually am a part of the team. I'm not aligned. I'm not identified. So what we had them do was wear lanyards at home, like putting on a badge. I'm putting on my badge. I'm in work. I'm taking off my badge. I'm out of work. Walk out of the bedroom, walk into the bedroom. And it was like their new belonging badge. I've seen so many people do so many different things, but we have got to help people actually relax, actually create the right amount of certainty and predictability, even in an environment that's chaotic. Now I'm going to stop talking because I've said a lot. I hope this is landing in your system in terms of the importance of it. Well, there's a lot to think about. So think about educating yourselves, managing yourselves, your implied behavior and how that impacts other people. Any questions?
Thanks a million, Richella. There's definitely a good few comments that are gone in there for you. And yeah, there's some questions there as well. So what's the biggest problem you see across small, medium-sized companies with blended hybrid model? That's for Ruairi and for Richella.
Go ahead, Ruairi, if you want to answer.
Yeah, the biggest problem is probably employees feel that they're not being treated as fairly by their co-workers. So that's why it's really important to have a policy in place. So where companies are going to run into issues, if you've, for example, three sales administrators and they let one of them work from home and they tell the other two, no, you have to be at your desk at all times or 4 days a week. And it's like, well, why, if Mary, who's doing the exact same job as me, why is she allowed to do 5 days a week from home? So that's the biggest problem people are facing or will be facing as the legislation kind of comes in and people have a bit more of a right. You can actually start reporting your employer to the workplace if they don't reply to your request for flexible working as well. So a lot of that, those type of things will probably feed into those complaints. And the other thing is what I saw is just employees got used to being at home. So they went from never working from home. Then with COVID, they're working 5 days a week from home. And they were literally just saying, yeah, I'll come back into the office for 1 day a week. That's it. And it's like, okay, well, you know, you need to come back in 4 days a week. And it's like, no, well, if I come back in more than 1 day a week, I'm resigning. So I've had loads of people resign for different clients in the past 6 or 12 months, just because that's it. They want to work from home and they have to quit their jobs as a result. That's what they're doing.
Richella, do you have anything to say on that as well?
And I don't want to repeat what I've already said, but I think one of the biggest challenges to working in a blended environment today is ensuring that we have that reciprocal exchange, because we're working through digital technology. So I am a big believer that you need to be focused on getting it right and helping people. And it isn't all about short-term payoff. You have to be able to, as a manager, somebody with the business, be able to speak well to the risks as well as the benefits. Because people in a threat environment, and it is threatening in the environment today, are more likely to think short-term. Your job is to help them think long-term. So even from a reciprocal exchange point of view, it's so important. If it was myself and Jackie, I see Jackie's on the screen there. If it was myself and Jackie, can you imagine if we were going to see each other once a week, but the last thing Jackie said to me didn't land well, and I was left with that as a system story, how many legs would it grow between that and the next time I see her? Unbelievable. Communication. How do we value visibly? How do we communicate correctly? How do we communicate not only with our spoken word, how we express ourselves, but also with how we look online? So if Jackie, you know, maybe, and I'm sorry for using you, I keep using you. If Jackie was, for example, in a meeting and maybe we weren't on Zoom, we could be on Teams or WebEx, so you can't see everybody, but she might make a comment and somebody there could go like this. They're left with that story where there is no social support where they can repair. So that rupture and repair of relationships is essential. So it's not all roses to work from home, but it is brilliant if you are able to manage. So I think there's a lot of people who shouldn't be given work from home unless they've learned what they need to adapt. Then they should be allowed to work from home and get better at regulating their own nervous system and managing themselves working from home. Or else you're likely to have much more of chaos that people are quitting, and we don't really know why they're quitting properly. Does that make sense? They're quitting because it's, I can't get on with my team anymore. And it mightn't be anything to do with the work or the company. So that's the leadership piece. The leadership piece has to be accountable to making sure that they're leading with all of those things in mind. So again, it's saying, how do we make a blended working work? Well, nobody wants to go in and do what they can do at home, but they want to be able to use the office to be able to connect, build team, collaborate, communicate, build culture. Does that make sense? So the whole office thing needs to change. But what if you've got a customer facing business at the same time? That's even a bigger reason why we need to bring people together. So we have to hold each other accountable to setting the standard around this.
Perfect. You know, you really, it's really informative. So it is. I see Michelle just has a question or a hand up, and we'll answer this and then we'll move on to Patrick, because there's thunder and lightning outside in case the power anything goes. Just so you know that. So I will get Michelle.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, Michelle.
Apologies, the camera is not on because I'm currently sitting in my car because I can't get out of the car because of the thunder and lightning.
Fair play for showing up.
I just have a quick question for both, and maybe for the third speaker as well. I'd love to hear your thoughts on quiet quitting and what you think about it, and thoughts and theories on it, because it seems to be something that's very topical at the moment, and it's really new. Well, I mean, maybe it's been there all the time, but now it's very topical. And the second, I guess, more of an observation, and it really resounded with me when you were talking, Richella, is for me, the work, the hybrid environment, the blended working environment, I feel like it's really changed the way that the office, when I'm in office, has changed. I find that they're probably my least productive days in terms of the work that I get done. But I see the benefit with the team, because I manage teams, so it's, you know, it's really that key in connecting with the team. But I actually feel that it's the most challenging days for me now, because I don't get the work done that I need to get done. So I'd love to know if, I don't know, are you feeling the same, are you hearing the same? And I'm going to put the mute on now because it's absolutely laughing.
No, Michelle, you're not the only one who feels like that. That is a general consensus, because we haven't learned how to use the office as a tool. People are still seeing it like a destination where work needs to get done, where your day-to-day needs to get done. So it's how do we adapt to that and be aspirational with that in mind? Nobody's going to get this right overnight. But to me, the quiet quitting is much more about people's FOMO, fear of missing out, fear of missing out actually about what goes on in the office because they feel isolated at home. It's much more to do with FOPO, fear of other people's opinion. What does that look like? Need for external validation, need for support, need for each other. It's the human to human piece that's completely gets lost sometimes in a business. So as much as we need to absolutely keep the business as the priority, everything needs to flow around that to be able to go, how do we balance the business needs with the role needs, with the employee needs, and do it all well? Does that make sense? It has to all happen well. I'm going to stop talking now.
Thanks for your credit, Richella. Sorry. So we are going to move on to Patrick. So you can take over there now.
Thanks very much. It's a very interesting conversation. And I'm conscious of the lightning because I'm right next to I'm in our offices too in Galway.
We have
all the windows looking out.
I keep glancing out because I just see the blue coming on.
And I'm seeing his flashes. And I'm out in my cullen. I'm involved with breathing for about 20 years. And now in the last 7 or 8 years or so, I work a lot with breathing to change states. And as Richella was talking about the autonomic nervous system, you know, a lot of the stuff that's going in our mind is often reflective of our physiology. And as a kid growing up and into my early 20s, I had very poor sleep and undiagnosed sleep apnea. I used to wake up feeling very, very tired, and I would also fall asleep in school. And at 14 years of age, I left school altogether. I'd never written about it or spoken about it up until about 2 years ago. I left school because I was sitting in the classroom without the energy levels and the ability to hold my attention and focus. Now, lo and behold, I did go back to school a year later, and I worked to get into university, got there, got my degree, but it took a lot of work. 16 years of formal education, and we are not taught how to concentrate. I went to business school, and we are not taught how to manage stress. I come out of BESS and TCD. I graduated in 1997. I worked for an American multinational. I absolutely hated it. I hated going in every single Monday morning. And that's being genuine about it. And the reason that I hated it was not necessarily the company, but I wasn't in a good position to be able to cope with the stresses that the company was placing. Because stresses that we perceived are not necessarily based on the situation, but oftentimes it's our own physiology. And I was lucky enough, I came across the importance of breathing and knowing about breathing to change states. And I trained under a Ukrainian doctor. Now, roll on 20 years, we are located in 50 countries. We have 3,000 instructors. I've written 9 books. I work with many influential people. I won't mention names, but one I can mention is Coldplay, Chris Martin, because it's public. You'll see it. I do work with snipers, special weapons and tactics, Navy SEALs. I've worked with Delta Forces, Royal Air Force, etc. I'm the guy that goes in and shows them how to breathe into upregulate and downregulation. There's some very, very simple tools that if we know the connection between our breathing and our physiology, by changing our breathing, it can help to downregulate so we don't go into that fight or flight response. I was listening to a podcast by Dr. Rangan Chatterjee going back about, it was in May in 2021. And he was interviewing a brain surgeon called Dr. Rahul. And you can imagine a brain surgeon, this must be the one of the most stressful jobs possible. And Dr. Rahul said, when I get into a tricky situation, the first thing I do is not hyperventilate. And I was just listening to myself and I was thinking to myself, here you have a brain surgeon that knows this, but how many other people know that? How many of us get into a tricky situation? And when we get into a tricky situation, it is a very normal reaction that our breathing gets faster, our breathing gets upper chest, we have a regular breathing. We sigh more, we may mouth breathe, we breathe harder. Now, when we get into that situation, what's the body telling the brain? The body is telling the brain that the body is under threat, and the brain is here to protect the body, and all the brain wants to do is get you out of the situation. One person will get into a trickier situation easier than others based on their own physiology. If you have an employee or if you yourself already have a habit of breathing a little bit faster and a little bit harder, that you're already almost in that fight or flight response, but not quite. It doesn't take much to throw you over the edge. But in terms of resilience and recovery and heart rate variability and bringing a balance to the autonomic nervous system, there's various techniques that you can do to self-regulate, and it makes you more resilient. If you're more resilient, you can take things a little bit better in your stride. Things happen, but they won't affect you as much. Life becomes a little bit softer and situations become softer. And the other aspect about this is, can you concentrate and hold your attention when your physiology is on the verge of a fight or flight response? Because when we go into that fight or flight response, it's not a time for thinking straight. It's not a time for planning. It's an emergent situation to get us out of there. So one of the best things that I had started, and that was 20 plus years ago, it's 1998 now, was getting my mouth closed during sleep. I used to wake up with a dry mouth every morning. If you wake up with a dry mouth every morning, your sleep is lighter. And already you're not going to have the same mental capacity that you would have in comparison to the way it should be if your mouth is closed. So I would say, don't wake up with a dry mouth in the morning. It's really, really vital. If you have your mouth open in the morning, or if you're sleeping with an open mouth during sleep, your sleep is going to be lighter. And especially with men, because we are more prone to sleep disorder breathing, obstructive sleep apnea, snoring, and insomnia. The next aspect of it is a very simple hack that when you do get into a tricky situation, bring your attention inwards. And when you're thinking about the breath in and the breath out, it's all in the exhalation. The breath in is more the vagus nerve is, well, basically the breath in has got nothing to do with activating a stress response or a relaxation response. Take a normal breath in through your nose and have a really slow and relaxed and gentle exhalation. If you have a slow and relaxed and a gentle exhalation, your body is telling the brain that things are okay, and your brain will send signals of calm to the body. And this is known since 1905, that by taking a soft breath in through your nose and that really slow and relaxed and gentle exhalation, you stimulate what's called the vagus nerve, which secretes a substance called acetylcholine. And acetylcholine causes the heart rate to slow down. And when your heart rate is slowing down, your brain interprets that the body is safe. The other aspect about this is that when a difficult situation presents itself, overthinking doesn't necessarily solve the situation. We have overthought things to death. And when you overthink, there's no room for a solution to enter. And the other thing about overthinking is that we can often magnify the problem into a situation. We're adding drama, we're adding color, we're repeating it over and over and over and over our heads. Something happened once, that happened one time, but we have been doing it to ourselves ever since. It's very important to, when you feel, and by having that connection inwards, because a lot of people, if we're solely stuck in our head, we're kind of disconnected from the body that we don't really feel then when we're getting into stress. Now, we as human beings, we are not good with long-term stress. And somebody brought up burnout syndrome. It's been very understudied the effect that burnout syndrome and your breathing has. But in one published paper, it was 2013 in Sweden, they talked about chronic stress being one of the most common diagnoses in the form of exhaustion syndrome in Sweden. And this would be burnout. And all of the individuals with burnout syndrome had hyperventilation syndrome. In other words, in the workplace, they're feeling the stress and strains of the workplace. They are responding by having faster and harder breathing. That faster and harder breathing is tipping them into a fight or flight response. And it's going to impact their sleep and it will impact their physiology. And chronic overbreathing can cause blood vessels to constrict, oxygen delivery to reduce, and activating and putting you into that fight or flight response. We can't cope with that long term. So whenever we have stresses and strains, it's really important. And especially you can do this if you're working from home. Take 5 or 10 minutes out. Bring your attention inwards. This isn't just about focusing on the breath, but this is deliberately influencing your breathing pattern to change states. And we'll go through it for about 4 minutes or so. So what I would like you to do is to put one hand on your chest, one hand just above your navel, And I would like you to bring your attention out of your mind and onto your breathing and use this as a measurement of your concentration. For how long are you able to hold your attention to your breathing before your mind is wandering? And if you find that your mind is wandering a lot, you know that your concentration, which is your capacity to hold attention, has got room for improvement. With this exercise, I would like you to take a very soft breath in through your nose. And I would like you to have a really slow and relaxed and gentle breath out. And when you take that soft breath in, take in about 70% of the breath into the nose. In actual fact, I need you to underbreathe. So you're taking a very soft, gentle breath coming into your nose. And you're having a really relaxed and a slow and a gentle breath out. I would like you to find out what happens when you breathe a little bit less air. What happens when you breathe a little bit less air to the point that you have air hunger? That signifies that there's a gas, carbon dioxide, increasing in the blood. And as carbon dioxide increases in the blood, it improves blood flow to the brain. And it also increases oxygen delivery to the brain. So let's continue, and then I will give you my piece towards the end of it. You're taking a really soft and slow, gentle breath in through your nose. You're having a relaxed and a slow and a gentle breath out. And then a very, very soft and slow, gentle breath in. And a relaxed and a slow and a gentle breath out. I would like you to soften and then slow down your breath to the point that you have a tolerable air hunger. Ironically, when you're breathing soft and light, as you're doing in this situation, it improves your blood circulation and oxygen delivery. The idea that the harder and the faster you breathe and taking that big breath is going to bring more oxygen to the brain is the greatest myth that has ever been put out there. If you want to oxygenate your brain, breathe lightly. Healthy people breathe light. Calm people breathe light. Unhealthy people breathe hard, breathe fast, breathe upper chest, breathe mouth. People who are stressed, anxious, panic disorder, depressed, 75% of the population with anxiety and panic disorder have dysfunctional breathing. It's not just about low and slow breathing, although Adrian is correct. We use the acronym LIGHT, slow and deep. Light is also very important, and light often doesn't get the attention. Light is about improving your blood circulation and oxygen delivery. Light is about softening the breath to increase carbon dioxide in the blood to stimulate the vagus nerve. How do you know if you're helping to activate the body's rest and digest response? With the rest response, you feel sleepy. With the digest response, you've got increased watery saliva in your mouth. Whenever you're doing a breathing exercise, if you have an understanding of the basic components of what that breathing exercise is doing, if you hyperventilate, it's a stressor. It's activating a stress response. If you do a long breath hold, it's a stressor. If you breathe nose, it helps to bring together functional breathing. The mouth does nothing for the breath. If you breathe light, it helps to improve your breathing overall. Slow breathing stimulates the vagus nerve. Low breathing stimulates the vagus nerve. If you bring this into your way of life, you will be more resilient to stressful situations. And it's the one tool that if I was asked, if I never worked with anybody, it has helped me as a small business owner for 20 plus years. And things do happen. When you have your breath there, you can alter your breath to change your states. And it's very important. So I shall leave it at that.
Oh, thanks a million, Patrick. I've read some of your stuff before. We're actually going to even give away one of your books. And I'll see that later. Breath work. It's amazing. Everyone needs to learn breathing techniques. Even customers that come in here, especially like anyone who does like the flotation therapy, we just say something about even about calming the mind and the body. Just to come out of your mind has to be your breathing technique. But the cold plunge, I think, is the best example. You have to control your breathing, because if you start hyperventilating your thoughts, you won't last 30 seconds in there. But the very minute you just focus on your breathing, calm the mind, you can stay in there for 5 minutes. It might be cold to your feet, but your mind is calm. So, you know, breathing technique, it's just, there's just so many people that need to be educated on it a bit more, and especially in the workplace. I think, yeah, for like employees who might feel a bit overwhelmed, or managers or leaders in that position. And then again, like their energy kind of flows out onto the employees, and that's the mismatch with management and keeping happy staff. So a lot of it is like that nervous system and breathing and just keeping it nice, calm and controlled. You know, thanks, William. That's really, really informative.
Thanks, Nicola.
And anybody got any questions for Patrick? This one's an obvious for how do you... Okay, so this might be an obvious question, but how do you ensure you breathe through the nose while sneaking?
It's a very good question. I started taping my mouth about 24 years ago. And I used a paper tape that I bought from a chemist, but I also used nasal dilators to keep my nose open. So I remember the first morning waking up and I didn't feel much of a difference, but the second morning I woke up, it was the best night's sleep I ever had. And I've literally continued taping my mouth to this day. Now, taping the mouth is actually becoming now a worldwide phenomenon. From a business perspective, Shark Tank in the United States, two guys decided then to bring out this tape. And they presented it there, and Mark Cuban invested $500,000 for a 20% stake in the company. We have our own tape because we work a lot with children, and we, of course, we can't tape a child's mouth. So we invented what's called myotape, and this is sold internationally, and it's with Nicola's soul therapy. And it's a tape that surrounds the mouth to bring the lips together. So it's safe because if you do have to mouth breathe in an emergency, you can have your mouth open, but the tape is bringing the lips together. And we sell that internationally throughout the world. It's priced in dollars because most of our market is North America. Yeah, so even though we're based in Galway, about 12 staff here, 95% of our business is overseas.
Yeah. Yeah, I found that fascinating when I first came across your business, how much it was in the States, and you've worked with some amazing people and teams and everything. But back to the mango tape that you have, like Adrian, he uses that, and it was just like a game changer because he would have snored. So that automatically affects me. So because he tapes his mouth now, and like that, it is perfectly safe. But he's finding his sleep is so much better, that he wakes up the next day that he's clearer thoughts. Everything is just in so much better focus. And again, I'm getting better sleep when his mouth's taped as well.
I suppose it comes back to this, Nicola. People talk about flow states in business, that state of mind whereby you're in total alertness and relaxation at the same time. You're not going to achieve flow state if you have poor sleep and if your physiology is in the fight or flight response. And that needs to be considered, I think. Yeah.
I think Michelle has used your brand. She didn't know you were based in Galway.
Well, good. Thanks, Michelle.
Yeah. A few people that are interested in the tape. So has anyone any more questions for Patrick or for any of our speakers?
Can I just mention, Nicola, we're bringing out a new app in about a month's time.
I have heard, yeah.
And it's pretty much going to contain about 100 different videos, and we put $150,000 into it. This app is going to be downloadable for free and available for free, no subscription. So the whole purpose of the app is to drive awareness of breathing. And for us, my objective is that the app is downloaded about $500,000 times. That's why we haven't monetized it, but we've put in the money to it. So we've invested it personally. It's self-funded. The app could be a very useful tool because it will give different customized plans and to develop habits for individuals that want to learn breathing exercises. And it goes beyond mindfulness. And mindfulness, I am a total fan of it. However, when your mind is in an emotional turmoil, the last thing you want to do is pay attention to what's going on in the mind. And when the mind is in an emotional turmoil, it can make you anxious focusing your attention on your breathing. So there are specific things that you can be doing if a person has a background of anxiety and panic disorder, and it will be all free in the app, but it will be out in about 4 weeks' time or so. The app will be called Oxygen Advantage, our website. It's one of our websites, Oxygen Advantage, but that's what the app will be called.
Okay, brilliant. That sounds amazing. I just seen there, Jackie has a question.
Yeah, sorry, I was just wondering about sleep apnea, Patrick. I think this is really fascinating. And I'm just wondering if breathing techniques would replace all those CPAP machines and all that stuff for somebody who's suffering from sleep apnea, or can it?
It can make quite an influence. I wrote a paper on this with two ear, nose and throat doctors. It's called Breathing Reeducation and the Phenotypes of Sleep Apnea. And I also spoke at the World Sleep Congress in March of this year. It was attended by 2,700 medical doctors. They have done no research on breathing during the day. And this is sometimes the frustrating part from my point of view. And I told them, because you cannot make money from teaching breathing techniques. Now, you might think that I'm biased in saying that, but what drives research is often commercial profit, especially when it's conducted by private enterprise. How you breathe during the day is going to influence how you breathe during your sleep. Your diaphragm breathing muscle is mechanically linked with the upper airway dilator muscles in the throat. If you have your mouth open, your tongue is on a midway or on the floor, and as a result, it can narrow the airway. And also mouth breathing causes inflammation of the airway to cause narrowing of the airway to contribute to obstructive sleep apnea. We can never say that we would ever cure obstructive sleep apnea. And the only way to find this out would be to do a sleep study. But if you go in on PubMed, or even if you sent us an email, and we will send you on the paper. Now, it's a scientific paper, but it's readable. I would say for people, especially with the CPAP machine, 50% of people abandon the CPAP machine. They cannot comply with it. So it's crying out for attention, and changing breathing patterns during the day can help with that. And it can help quite significantly as well. But person to person, we can never say how much is it going to reduce their AHI. But I would say at the very minimum, it will reduce it by 30%.
Quite an incredible statistic. Thanks for that.
Thanks, Jackie.
Thanks a million, Patrick, and all our speakers. That was so informative. I know I'm just a bit cautious now of time because we're running a bit over. But yeah, I know loads of information there for everyone. Thank you so much. We have that recorded as well. So anyone who has been on here, we can email it over. Just so you can go back to some of the points, because there's just so much information there. And Lorraine, it's on Patrick's Oxygen Advantage website. The app will be there in 4 weeks. Yeah. Sorry, are you muted? Sorry, how'd you meet you, Patrick?
Yeah, 4 weeks is the planned date. It's been going on for about 12 months or so. So, you know yourself, you can have delay with developers, but that's the plan, 4 weeks' time.
Even if you email, we'll keep an eye on it anyways, but when we're launching, you can just email it over to us and we can let even people who are on this webinar give it directly out to them as well, just when it is out for purchasing and downloading.
Thanks, Nicola.
All right, thanks a million. Okay, so I am going to wrap that up. Again, conscious of time and the thunder and lightning.